what a welcome.
Birmingham is always marvellous, yes.
It seems to me that your English fans have stuck with you through thick and thin almost more than any others have.
Well, you know, Alan, I was here in 1961 with Helen Shapiro and Adam Faith back in those years, and the English fans have always been very faithful.
They're a loyal bunch once inspired, aren't they? They do tend to stick with the people they like and the music they like.
Oh, yes, I see many familiar faces here, the Admiration Society and many of the people who come to the concerts. I'm very happy to see them.
Now, I was reading the book and looking at the back of your autobiography, the list of songs, and it's page lists.
Not all hits,
but a good number of them were hits. I mean, is it totally spontaneous? Is it difficult to keep them in, or do you have to work hard? Now, I'm not saying it's easy to write songs, but you know what I mean? Do they absolutely pour out of you?
Oh, I wish, but it is hard work. I have to discipline myself, Alan, and sit down and say for the next 2 months I'm going to be at the piano and write for the next collection. And you become choosy with each new collection after 25 albums and 35 years. It's choosy, yes.
How did you start?
I started as a concert pianist. My mother worked very hard. She took an extra job. Dad was a taxi driver. And at 8 years old, I began playing the piano as a serious student. And then in 1958, I wrote a song for Connie Francis called Stupid Cupid, which changed the career direction, shall we say.
You worked with Howard Greenfield in those early years. Now, he was a lyricist, you were the composer. Did you meet at school or what?
His mother heard me playing piano when I was practicing my Chopin, and she suggested that I collaborate with him. He was a poet. I was 13 years old and he was 16, and little did I know that was the first song. And October the 11th, 1952 was the first of more than 500 songs with Howard.
That's a lot of songs.
Yes.
I know you wrote one in particular for a girlfriend of the time. A girl called Carole King.
Oh, that follows me around the world. This story follows me. I was dating Carole Klein, who became Carole King, and did an album called Tapestry, and that's how most of the people will remember her. But I did write in 1959, Oh Carole, for her.
59.
Oh.
I was around, actually. I'd like to say I wasn't, but I was.
You were very little.
Mind, I look different, but then you look different as well. And if you look at this, you'll see how different you looked. Here are you singing Oh Carole all those years ago.
Oh, Carole, I am but a fool. Darling, I love you, though you treat me cruel. You hurt me, and you make me cry. But if you leave me, I will surely die. Darling, there will never be.
That was stunning choreography. That was a Dick Clark show in 1959.
Right, Dick Clark was the television compere who did all of the rock and roll. I love the skinny tie, and my hair was so thick. Whatever happened to it?
You still got it.
I have.
She wrote a song in reply, didn't she?
Oh, yes, a terrible song. Oh, Neil, I've loved you for so long. I never dreamed you'd put me in a song. Not good.
What happened? What happened to it?
Oh, it was a collector's item. I think Pat and Sue are the only people that have it in Portsmouth.
We'll come to Pat and Sue in a bit. There were these most amazing years in this building called the Brill Building in what became to be known as Tin Pan Alley.
Yes.
And you and Howard sitting in a building, literally going in every day, 9 to 5, and writing songs, hopefully hits.
A great training. But yes, we had little cubicles with just a piano, no windows, just a little room, and once you had your first hit, then you graduated to a room with windows. That was your special treat, yes.
How long did it take you to get your window?
Oh, it took me several years, several years.
The music industry today, it seems, is no comparison with those years of hits, hit after hit after hit, pouring out of that one little area. Has it changed beyond all recognition?
Well, you know, there's more accountants and lawyers and business managers now, but those days were very spontaneous. They were very happy, carefree days, and I don't think we'll ever be able to recapture the 50s and 60s in the style, the culture, and the music.
We also get nowadays videos. I mean, every song, it seems, has to have a video.
Yes.
Do you have to therefore become part of this? If you want to launch a hit, you have to launch a video to go with it.
I'm glad you mentioned that. Palador Records is watching, and I'm sure we will do a video. But, you know, I was one of the first to do a video in 1964 or 65, I think. It was a Chino box. In Italy, there was a jukebox, and you put the coin in. There was a screen on top, and you saw the artist performing his song. And that was probably one of the first videos that I did in the 60s.
Which song?
It was done to Calendar Girl.
Well, do you know, it's very funny. Because we found it. If you think MTV is saucy, look at this.
Those little dance steps, we call that the frug in New York.
It really
was a little
came
dance.
On the choreography, didn't it,
yes.
From those early days?
Oh, yes.
Then, though, I mean, that was a huge time of hits, but the late 60s saw the advent of real rock and roll, of that the Beatles era, mm-hmm. and the real rock of that. And you faded then, but in this strange way and unique way, you came back. What was the turning point?
Well, an agent of mine suggested that I come to England, since we had such faithful fans here. And I brought Liba and the children, and we lived in London for nearly 3 years. And I had to start once again in the Golden Garter in Manchester and the Wookie Hollow in Liverpool. And Liba worked the lights, and there were about 30 people in the audience saying, "Oh, sing Calendar Girl." And I snuck in one of the new ones, and it took us a couple of years to come back to a contemporary audience.
That takes tremendous guts. When you've been a number one, and then you slide, to say, "No, I'm sticking at it," and to keep doing it, not saying, "I'm sorry, I'm top of the bill on nothing." Did you not find that very hard?
You had to swallow your pride, but I love what I do. I'm very fortunate, and I wanted to be back in front of the public with a vengeance. I needed to be. I felt I had more creative stuff inside.
And you still did, because you then went on to work with Phil Cody as lyricist. You did things like Laughter in the Rain.
Yes, yes.
But you've still got, I suppose, when you do make a comeback, and yours has been more than a comeback, you seem back to stay now, you've still got all that bag full of wonderful songs from the first time, which you can rely on and which people do still want to hear.
And isn't that something, the resurgence of the 50s and 60s, the stations, the music, the little children who come to the concerts ask for "Oh, Carol" and "Happy Birthday, Sweet 16. It's amazing.
Well, you know, I think, could I ask for it now? Could we have a bit of, do you want a bit of "Happy Birthday, Sweet 16? Yeah.
Tra la 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 la, happy birthday, sweet 16. Tra la 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 la, happy birthday, sweet 16. Tonight's the night I've waited for, because you're not a baby anymore. You turned into the prettiest girl I've ever. Again. Happy birthday, sweet 16. Tra la 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 la.
enough.
We've been looking for a backing group for this show for years. You're booked. You've not been mean with your songs in that you've, yes, you've sung a lot of them all yourself, but you've also handed them out to other people. I mean, there's that famous number that you handed to Connie Francis, who was a pretty good singer, wasn't she?
Oh, yes, and I'll never forget, Alan, on the session, Stupid Cupid, I was the piano player, and I was so exuberant and so overly enthusiastic that I was doing these things and I bled all over the piano. I killed the skin on my thumb. How did it go? Stupid Cupid, you're a real mean guy. I'd like to clip your wings so you can't fly. I'm in love and it's a crying shame, and I know that you're the one to blame. Hey, hey, set me free. Stupid Cupid, stop picking on me. The coda. Hey, hey, set me free. Stupid Cupid, stop picking on me.
Master that technique, I'd lose a fingernail every time I did that, I think, or a thumbnail. You trained at the Juilliard School. Lots of famous classical musicians went through there. The classics still something that you enjoy? Did you sort of leave it all behind?
I do. I play every evening in a concert, at least one classical piece, and I'll never forget the teachers at the Juilliard School were shocked. They said, "What is an Elvis Presley? What is this rock and roll?" And they were quite shocked at the beginning. But and my mother, I used to have to wait to write. My mother used to leave the house to go shopping, and then I could write the rock and roll. But then she got used to it. She got a mink stole, you see.
So she didn't mind it.
She didn't mind it.
Give us something that she would have liked.
She used to love Clair de Lune. And so on. That cost my father a lot of money.
Are there particular songs that you composed that were influenced by the classical repertoire?
I think being a studied musician, Alan, it was definitely a rub in my own writing. This one was certainly classically inspired. There was a man, a lonely man, who lost his love through his indifference. And solitaire's the only game in town. Every road that takes him down. While life goes on around him everywhere, he's playing solitaire. A little Chopin-esque.
Yeah, Andy, please have a little power. Now, Andy Williams performed that one.
Andy Williams, Connie Francis, Elvis Presley.
Wow.
I've been very, very fortunate. Many great singers.
Are you a good judge of a song? Can you predict which one is going to be a hit?
Sometimes, but through the years, you know, I've had some very bad decisions. I was an absolute fool with this song. It was in an album of mine, and after Laughter in the Rain, I chose to put out The Immigrant and completely forgot about Love Will Keep Us Together. The only person who was on me was Liba's mom, my mother-in-law, who said, "You know, it's 1976 and it's love that keeps people together." And I stupidly didn't put it out, but it was a Grammy for the Captain and Tennille. Song.
around. You just gotta be strong. Now stop, 'cause I really love you. I think I took the riff from Brazil, Brazil. La 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 la. I'm allowed though. It's enough of that.
You mentioned Elvis and people. Was it? Are you like me, a bit starstruck? Was it a thrill writing for people like Elvis when they took
Absolutely.
A song that you'd written? Could you? Gosh, Elvis is singing my
Absolutely.
Song.
Absolutely. We saw him just a year before his death at the Las Vegas Hilton. Lieber and I went, and Elvis gave her a scarf, which she still has to this day. And then Elvis and I sat at the piano in his dressing room, and we sang some gospel songs together. I've always been a great fan. Yes, I'm basically starstruck, of course.
Now, you've written so many songs, and I know you met Richard Rodgers. Now, didn't Richard of Rodgers and Hammerstein fame, didn't he try and persuade you to write a musical?
He did many years ago, and I think one of these days I will come to it, because people have said that the melodies and the songs would lend themselves very well to a stage.
So. What sort of places give you inspiration? I mean, do you get your inspiration for a song from the most unlikely things? You're doing somewhere, you are somewhere, and you think, oh, I'll write a song about this or whatever.
You can get it from people, places, books, movies, relations. Sometimes you get it in the middle of the night, and that can be very distressing, because the melody will haunt me for several hours and I'll be up all night trying to complete it. But,
didn't you even get inspiration once from a restaurant?
Yes. Howie Greenfield.
How do you get inspiration from a restaurant? You're dining out. Oh, I've got a song.
Yes, we were sitting at a restaurant in London called The Hungry Years, and Howie said that would make a marvelous song title. And it was a little hamburger joint. And to this day, we've saved the menu and framed it, The Hungry Years. Girl, we made it to the top. We went so high, we couldn't stop. We climbed the ladder, leading us nowhere. The two of us together, building castles in the air, with French fries. Spun so fast we couldn't tell, the gold ring from the carousel. How could we know the ride would turn out bad? Everything we wanted was everything we had. I miss the hungry years, the once upon a time, the lovely long ago, we didn't have a dime. Those days of me and you, we lost along the way. Little Chinese food here. How could I be so blind not to see the door closing on the world I now hunger for? Looking through my tears, I miss the hungry years. You never know where they come.
You've got a tremendous number of fans. An awful lot of them are here in the audience. We've got time to say hello to a few, or for a few rather, to say hello to you. Pauline and Ken Allen. Now, you had rather a special 25th wedding anniversary, didn't you, Ken?
Yes, we booked a ticket and went across to California to see Neil in concert. Five nights running, in fact, at Caesars.
Is he good to his fans, Pauline?
Oh, he's marvellous. He invited us out for a meal to celebrate our anniversary. We had a very special 2 hours with Neil and his sister.
Ronnie joined
us,
that's right.
Right.
I know Ken and Pauline for many, many years, since Blighties and The Last Drop Hotel.
Wonderful days.
They've been absolutely terrific people.
You see, you obviously inspire a great lot in Marjorie Pilkington. She's in. Marjorie, you've been corresponding with Neil since 1962. Your dad next to you is 80. This is Pop Pilkington. I reckon he's one of your oldest fans, I think, Neil.
But still going strong. We go back to the Batley variety days.
Good heavens. Is Lee Rigby about? There's Lee, he's 14. So he's the other end of the scale there behind Pop. And you've, I think, followed him to America. And two ladies sitting on the very end of the front row. We've got here Pat Smith and Sue Tebbutt, the Neil Sedaka Appreciation Society.
Thank you.
These are two pretty special ladies, I gather.
They are more than fans. They have become very dear friends of Liba and Mark and Dara, and they have been enormously supportive. They have every record, every newspaper clipping, every video, and they'll tell you, they'll tell you.
What's special about him? And he's not here, ignore him, you know what?
Everything. The music, the man, everything.
He seems to me also to have a lot of time for his fans. I see a lot of people like him, you know, and some of them are very nice when they're sort of there, but then they run away from the stage door at the end. This chap doesn't seem to do that.
He spends a lot of time with the fans. When he comes to Portsmouth, he comes round in the afternoon for a cup of tea and a chat.
We took Mark Sedaka to their home in Portsmouth. Yeah. And they have a newsletter every couple of months and tell the fans where we'll be doing our concerts. And you know, on their own expense, these people travel from city to city on their own, check into a hotel, and when I can help them, of course, with tickets for the concerts, I do. But they have been absolutely above and beyond the call of duty.
They know more about you than you, don't they, really?
Yes.
I reckon that kind of loyalty deserves a request. Do you want a request?
Breaking Up is hard to do.
That was quick.
The old version.
If you sing the background, Pat and Sue. Do-do-do-down, do-be-do-down-down. Do 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 down, do down, down. Not my best lyric. Not sober. Down, do be do down, down. Breaking up is hard.
You know, there's a saying in England, and that is, behind every good man, there's a good woman. Telling him he's wrong most of the time.
Tell me I'm right.
And behind you, there's a pretty special woman, because not only is she wife, is she your wife, she's your manager as well.
Liba and I will be celebrating our 30th wedding anniversary, and she has been managing the career for a good 15 years.
And a very fine job she's made of it. Time we met the woman behind the man, ladies and gentlemen, Liba Sedaka. How did you meet?
At my mother's hotel. Neil had the orchestra, all four pieces, and I was working behind the desk, and he says that he told the trumpet player, I'm going to marry that girl.
So it was love at first sight with
you? She was 16 and I was 19. It was absolutely...
Don't give away how old I am.
But we won't say.
Yes, we dated for a couple of years, and then we were engaged in 62.
Was it love at first sight for you as well?
He said to me, my name is Neil Sedaka, and I wrote a song for Connie Francis called Stupid Cupid. I said, don't be ridiculous. I wouldn't know anyone that would write a song. And then it was on the radio, and I said, well, he couldn't make it up. And over the summer, I thought, oh, he is nice.
It grew and grew.
It grew and grew, yes, it did.
Are musicians notoriously temperamental? Difficult people to live with.
I only live with one.
Unpredictable.
Unpredictable, but not temperamental. Is he very good and very loving. What you see is what you get.
He's not a moody man, though.
No, not at all. I'm the moody one. He's very lovely.
Just buy beautiful clothes for Libra and she'll tell wonderful things about you.
You're such a crawler, Sedaka. Now, your children, Mark and Dara,
yes.
I mean, Dara we saw performing with you last time you were on here. It was a lovely piece of film
with
Symphony you performing.
Hall.
Yes.
They're now in their 20s, I gather, those two.
Yes, they are.
What are they doing now?
Dara is a jingle singer, does radio and television commercials in New York, And Mark is graduating the film school, the famous film school in New York City.
He's going to be Steven Spielberg.
It's a modest ambition, isn't it, really? What? I mean, to be Steven Spielberg, very modest.
Well, he's not asking for much.
No, not really.
And I have my dress for the Oscars.
You've got it already. I think we've embarrassed Neil quite enough. I thought it was
now you'll embarrass me.
I wouldn't embarrass you either for the world. I embarrass your children, though. We've got some footage here of both of them. A good deal earlier on than now. Mark first, and then Dara to follow. Look at it.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Mark Sedaka, and I would like to introduce you to the most absolute greatest composer and singer in the whole wide world. My father, Neil Sedaka.
Standing on the outside, looking in.
After a while, we run out.
After a while,
I turn to him and he kisses me.
Yeah.
Down with the beat of the rain on the leaves. Softly he breathes and I close my eyes.
When they left home, it was so traumatic for me. I know that they have to grow up and leave, but it took me a year to get over it. It was awful.
He'd walk from room to room. Oh,
where are they? They've flown. I can't imagine, or I can imagine, the magic of having your daughter sing your own song. It must be special.
It was extraordinary. She was going through an awkward period, and her braces...
She doesn't look like that.
She looks stunning now. We've got a picture of her, what she looks like now, with you and her family. She grew up, didn't she?
A marvellous, marvellous voice. We have delicious children. We're very proud of both of them. And Dara is on the coming album with me, on the... some new songs she'll be singing with me.
Well, look, we've heard lots of the old favourites today. I can't resist asking about the new one. You've got this album coming out, but there's a single being released first. What's it called?
The single is You Turn Me On, and it comes from an album that will be on later on in October. I think we'll call it Tune Weaver, and it has 15 new songs, but this is the first single before the album.
How do you compose now? As quickly as before, or do you take your time over it more now?
Oh, you're very choosy, and after so many songs and 20-some-odd albums over the years, you have to really be very choosy and challenge yourself.
And do you get a say, Lieber? Does he let you have a word in?
I am tone deaf, which is probably the success of my marriage.
not stone deaf.
Just tone deaf.
Yes. Tone deaf. Let's hear You Turn Me On from Neil Sedaka.
All right.
Thank you.
You turn me on like I never knew. Maybe shake inside. I'm not ready for you. Yeah, you blow my mind and you drive me crazy. I'm a helpless soul. I'm losing control. Yeah, you turn me on and I feel the heat. Yeah, you drive me wild with every beat of this foolish heart. And I start to shiver. Doing to me, you make me shake. You make me shiver. I feel it deep. I start to quiver. There's a passion I'm feeling through the night. Make me tossing and turning at the side. That's in my a feeling I have I can't explain, and I know that I'll never be the same again. Yeah, you turn me on. heaven. Oh, baby,
oh, baby,
what you doing to me? Will you turn me on when I look at you? Might explode. What can I do when I see you move? Just grows, you make me